Only one can imagine how different movies and television would be today if Blockbuster had joined forces with Netflix. Would cable still be the powerhouse they once were? Would Netflix be what it is now, being the leading force of video streaming? Would there have been other platforms and companies that would have come up, such as Hulu and numerous others? Many people look back at the year 2000 when Blockbuster had the opportunity to join forces with Netflix and ponder numerous questions. To see the whole picture, one must realize that Netflix back in 2000 was nowhere near what it is today. Blockbuster was still a successful video rental store and had over 9,000 stores worldwide by its peak in 2004. Netflix was struggling while Blockbuster was nearing its peak in 2000. Reed Hastings, a co-founder of Netflix, had said before that Netflix was projected to lose $50 million in 2000 and were desperate for a meeting with Blockbuster. Netflix had just turned down an offer by Amazon for $12 million, but were intrigued with the idea of Blockbuster to help keep Netflix around and bring them into the 21st century, and asked numerous times for a meeting with Blockbuster. Reed Hastings, along with fellow co-founder Mark Randolph and CFO Barry McCarthy, were in a retreat in California when they got a call that Blockbuster accepted a meeting with them. The issue was, the meeting was scheduled in less than 12 hours. Holding all hopes, they rushed and spent $20,000 to charter a plane to get them to Dallas, Texas as soon as possible. Using the airplane of Vanna White from Wheel of Fortune fame, they arrived in Dallas and hurried to the meeting in Blockbuster's headquarters. Dressed casual and tired from their previous night's retreat, John Antioco and numerous other Blockbuster executives sat in the room. Antioco, Blockbuster CEO since 1997, sat and listened to what good this merger or acquisition of Netflix could do for his company. During 2000, Netflix was still a DVD by mail company and far away from the streaming platform that they are today. Netflix knew that teaming with Blockbuster would bring them to the next level. They had previously turned down Amazon's acquisition in hopes that Blockbuster, who had more video know-how and access, would be able to help keep them from failing. Netflix said their proposal to Blockbuster while Antioco sat and listened. Hastings spoke of the two joining forces and Netflix would operate the online business while Blockbuster would focus on their stores. With the dot-com boom happening in the late 1990s and into the early 2000s, Blockbuster was leery. Knowing Netflix was an online company was a worry to Antioco and Blockbuster general counsel Ed Steed. After hearing what Netflix had to say, Steed wanted to get to the point and asked what they wanted for Netflix. Hastings answered $50 million. Supposedly, according to Hastings, a slight grin appeared on Antioco's face as if he was trying not to laugh. After a moment or so of speaking amongst themselves, Blockbuster declined the offer and did not make a single counteroffer. Netflix knew the meeting was over. Whether motivated after the meeting to outlast and beat Blockbuster, after the meeting, they likely knew they couldn't rely on anyone else but themselves. Blockbuster did make a deal with Enron in 2000 to get into the video-on-demand services, but the 20-year deal ended within a year, with Enron not thinking Blockbuster had enough films good enough for the service. Blockbuster finally did come out with a DVD subscription service on their website known as Blockbuster Online in 2004. They also set up kiosks to compete with Redbox, but by this time they were struggling too much to compete. While entering the DVDs by mail business, Blockbuster was gaining on Netflix and was a direct threat to Netflix's survival. During this time, though, Blockbuster was facing their own misfortunes. Blockbuster had their own internal drama and ousted Antioco as CEO, and in 2007, James Keyes was named CEO. During this time, Blockbuster was drowning in debt and turned their focus back onto their stores. If they hadn't focused so much on their stores, but instead their online business, Blockbuster would have enough ammo to have stayed in the DVD by mail game to compete, possibly passing Netflix. Hastings later admitted that, quote, "If it hadn't been for their debt, they could have killed us," end quote. In 2010, while Netflix gained 20 million subscribers, Blockbuster filed for bankruptcy and was purchased by Dish Network. 4 years later, the last 300 company-owned stores closed, losing over 80,000 jobs worldwide. Instead of teaming with Netflix in 2000, we're looking back at the possible powerhouse of Blockbuster and Netflix, and what they could have done with one another. Things could be different today. But, knowing how much Netflix had been struggling for survival in 2000, Antioco and Blockbuster didn't see the move beneficial. 20 plus years later, Blockbuster has one lonely location remaining in Bend, Oregon, who was allowed to remain open after paying Dish Network a licensing fee. Netflix, on the other hand, has gained the last laugh, as they now have over 200 million subscribers as of 2021, and they are the most dominant streaming platform as of this video. And who knows, even if Blockbuster would have purchased or joined with Netflix, who at the time in 2000 focused on DVDs by mail, that Netflix, even with Blockbuster's backing, would even be around today. Also, we'll never know how much streaming videos could be different today without Netflix's leading vision and the many other companies that followed.